Very good evening, everyone. And our group discussed good legal interventions in secured rivers. And our group had, by and large, a broad consensus on the problems. But as usual, we didn't have a lot of very concrete answers. But we tried our best to see which are the possible ways. And even in identifying the problems itself, to get to present which can be the possible answers. So these were some of the issues that we raised, because one of the things that Mr. Mishra mentioned in the morning was that the people who make decisions are the people who are least affected by them, especially in the context of environment and rivers. And likewise, from our personal experiences also, we see that the people who are most affected by decisions regarding environment or rivers are the people who are least equipped to protect themselves from it, which is why we need good legal interventions, and we need to bridge this gap between the people who are affected by them and the avenues and the laws that are designed to protect them. So there's a very major need to raise the public information and have greater participation and get over the collective action problem, and also the intimidation that formal legal avenues and procedures face to somebody who's outside this very professional and technical field. And for that, we need the legal awareness of rights, legal awareness of avenues, and legal awareness of procedures as and awareness of procedures as well. And we also, as a group, we realize what are the in addressing the legal interventions, we understand that there is the legislation aspect of it and there is the litigation aspect of it. And the fact that litigation as a strategy has very inherent problems. And the fact that it is generally used as a last stop measure, it is generally as a stopgap measure, and also in most cases as a delaying tactic. If the underlying discourse and the laws and policies doesn't change, then the legal interventions cannot be effective in its true meaning and spirit. But at the same time, we have to make use of whatever avenues are there before us and use these avenues creatively. So, and even through legal strategies, we can use good data and strategies to have a sort of precedential values and develop a jurisprudence which will provide a good backing for future interventions to come. The main problem which we kept facing time and again was the problem of reliable data and information. To make any point, to convince any judge or to convince any lawmaker, you need to provide a credible data and information about what exactly the problem is. And no matter at what stage it is, if there is a committee that is formed, there will be another committee report that gives another contradictory view. And data is never apolitical, and it is the uncertainty of data and the nature of scientific data that can be presented to have a convincing legal argument. That was one thing that was discussed, and we don't really have a proper answer to it, rather than having institutions that are reliable both at the government level and at the non-government level, and having a standardized set of data to rely on so that the process is more transparent and less arbitrary. And also we saw that the legal battles run parallel to the situation in the ground, and the one always informs the other. So it was very encouraging to listen to the successful stories of community participation. And also in our discussions with the people who have had successful stories was that their awareness of laws and how to use it. So if we can integrate the two a little better, then our battle is half won. Coming to the aspect of laws, we saw that some of the laws are outdated, and there are huge gaps in standards. So how do we use litigation as a strategy to address these? And some of the solutions was to maybe involve best practices from other countries, maybe involve the right to environment with the right to life, and try and bridge these gaps to develop a sort of a framework to protect the rights even when the laws are inadequate, and give a push from the side of litigation to have a more sound framework for this. And it was also an observation that procedural laws are easier to enforce than substantive laws. So, for instance, pollution issues are easier to address than issues relating to what should be the model of development and again, the inherent limitation of litigation as a strategy, because the courts cannot and should not decide that. So this needs to run parallel with the greater underlying discourse that is there. And we need greater role of local communities and PRIs, which unfortunately there are greater discussions about the political direction going against this. But we need to make a very strong point for more and more involvement of local level institutions at the level of governance as well as at the level of enforcement of rights. In litigation, I already covered some of these points, so I'm not going to go over these in detail. And one of the greater things that we also saw from anecdotal evidence was that a lot of it depends on the mindset and orientation of the judges. So if there is a girl, if the matter is before a judge and he's inclined a certain way, he will be more receptive to certain ideas than others. So the orientation of the judges needs to be there, and that can also happen through a greater level of journalism or greater level of discussion and meetings like this with a charter that can show that these are the high critical issues and bring these issues to light, because a lot of the times the decisions are probably not made on the basis of complete and proper information. And among litigation strategies, we were looking at the role of trial courts and the possibility of enforcement of penal provisions, because a lot of the discourse nowadays is regarding the role of the National Green Tribunal, and that is also regarding civil disputes and not regarding, and the role of trial courts and penalty provisions are not very well discovered, and that should be taken up as a litigation strategy as well. And again, there are the inherent problems of these as well, because any sort of criminal prosecution will have a higher burden of proof, and as it is, proving any point in environmental data is contested as it is, so penalty provisions can be difficult to enforce. But we could look at accountability of institutions holding the government to its promises. If a policy paper if a report says that 24 dams should be scrapped, then what can be the reason for changing, if for a subsequent report which might just say that no, all 24 dams are perfectly fine. So holding the institutions accountable and looking at a consistency of strategy, and wherever there is a change, looking for explanations for these change. And also we explored the idea of identifying critical issues which can probably influence the discourse that can happen. For example, yesterday Mr. Jhunjhunwala was telling us about how he was looking at the Farakka barrage issue and trying to show that as a case study for not proceeding with the proposal of having a cascade of barrages along the Ganga as part of the Ganga waterway. So having identifying one or two very critical issues which can highlight a lot of underlying issues that are there. And the same was there for having the case for a cumulative impact assessment for hydro projects. At the present, there is the EIA notification, which in the form says that is one of the checklist items, are that is there a cumulative impact assessment. But if that gets reflected as a judicial order that yes, this is a mandatory procedure that has to be taken place, that gives more legitimacy to the claims that we as a group are trying to make, that these assessments are needed for a proper governance of the river. And similarly, for the enforcement of EC conditions, if it says that 15% of the flow should be in the water, who is there to ensure that it is being left there or not? And if they're not, what sort of legal justification do they have to provide for complying with the for complying or non-complying with this? So there is a lot of follow-up that is required. And again, highlighting the fact that was brought out by the previous group, that any community level struggle takes years and years, and it's a consistent approach. It's not a one-day thing, it's not a sudden thing, and it doesn't end with one good or bad decision from the court. There is a whole appellate procedure, and even if at the highest appellate authority there is a favorable decision, there is the matter of implementing the judicial decision and the order itself. So it needs constant follow-up at every single level, which is for which a Herculean effort is needed. But that is the most optimistic note on which I could end.
Thank you. Any questions, comments? Please be brief and relevant. Do you want me to say something? Please.
Go ahead. It was also pointed out that there are some ongoing cases. And which are relevant to the issues discussed. And if the organizers of this conference would like to take the opportunity of going to the judges of the Supreme Court, and it is possible there is a. Sorry. we have a very senior lawyer who is involved in the interlinking of Rivers case. The two of us had formulated the case and he argued it, and the case was in my name. But I think if you are interested in opposing that measure, it can be done. The case can be revived.
Thank you. Yeah. Yes.
I was wondering if your group had any example of a river secured through legal intervention at all? That's one. The second one is, legal interventions themselves being a tricky ground. Already that interlinking was mentioned because the Supreme Court itself then gives a directive to the state to expedite the process. And there are several projects where several violations of acts and judicial processes are carried out across the country in projects that we have seen. PESA, including every directive on tribal land regulation, all these are violated in the name of so-called public good. So considering that and so many petitions still pending in the courts all over the country, how good is legal intervention at all now, you know, in India?
See, there is definitely the limitation of litigation is as a strategy, and that was one of the first things that we as a group recognized. But still, if it leads to a certain set of guidelines to fill a gap that is not there. For instance, a cumulative impact assessment was ordered for the Alaknanda Basin on the basis of a legal intervention itself. So it is not the answer, but it can supplement the process and inform the process. It is definitely part of the process, and unless the underlying political will reflects the change, it is not going to change. But it can push for it, and if there are avenues available, we should use it to the maximum of our advantage. Because if you start holding people accountable, at least what is there in the law, if that is implemented, even that is beneficial to some extent.
Thank you. Yeah. Please be brief. I think we are overshooting the time.
Hello. मैं ये कहना चाहता हूँ सर कि पिछले कुछ सालों से हम लोग एक नदी को और वहाँ के पानी को लेकर लड़ रहे हैं, और हम लोग NGT में भी गए और हम लोगों ने कई RTI फाइल की, कई मुकदमे इधर उधर फाइल किए, लेकिन एक हम लोगों को समस्या आई, बहुत भयंकर समस्या, वो ये कि जो भी कोई आदमी पानी को पॉल्यूट कर रहा है, चाहे वो रिवर को कर रहा हो, चाहे वो अंडरग्राउंड वाटर को कर रहा हो, उसके खिलाफ कोई क्रिमिनल ऑफेंस नहीं बन रहा। मैंने तो बहुत ढूंढने की कोशिश करी, लेकिन अगर आप में से कोई हो तो मुझे बताए, और नहीं है तो नदी है मेरे शहर से गुजरती है, हिंडन नदी। तो मेरा ये सवाल है कि सर, एक हम लोग कुछ वर्षों से ये भी कहते आ रहे हैं कि नॉन बिलेबल ऑफेंस होना चाहिए, कोई भी आदमी अगर पानी को कंटेमिनेट करता है, पॉल्यूशन करता है, कि आपने 500 रुपये का जुर्माना कर दिया, आपने एक दिन के लिए उसकी फैक्ट्री बंद कर दी, आपने उसका बिजली का कनेक्शन काट दिया, इससे ज़्यादा कोई कुछ नहीं करता है ना। अभी हमारे यहाँ तो हज़ारों लोग कैंसर हो रहा है, मर रहे हैं, और कई लोग तो पीड़ित हैं। तो ये बात होनी चाहिए कानूनी लड़ाई के तहत कि हमें ये मांग रखनी चाहिए कि इस तरह के अपराध जो हैं वो
सुबह के सेशन में रिकमेंडेशन।
अच्छा ठीक है, अच्छा ठीक, कोई बात नहीं सर, मैंने एक बार वो सजेस्ट कर दिया, थैंक यू।
In the presentation at one place, it was said that it should be, it's somewhat like a last step recourse. In another place, it was said that legal initiatives as well as campaigns should go hand in hand. It's a bit self-contradictory, I think.
Yes. So as a last step recourse for one particular issue, so for instance, Project A on River X, but hand in hand can be for the whole movement in the in totality, because say the legal procedure will start after the environment clearance is granted, but even before the environment clearance there is the level of public consultation, the level of building itself, so it goes hand in hand. And even once the legal process starts, the community involvement cannot die, because once that dies, then the legal process is completely empty and meaningless.
I'm not. Just a minute.
Yeah. I'm part of the same group, so the clarification also is that legal strategy doesn't only mean a case filed in the court, but it can be larger action for amending laws, proposing different regulatory systems. So you know that more wider thing. So that's why it can go hand in hand.
Yeah, I'm in acceptance of that, but when you say it's a last step recourse, it may not.
For example, if you go to the judge, I mean judiciary, and say that this dam should be stopped, and the judiciary says no, the project should go ahead, then that is a blow to the movement itself. In that sense, there is a problem in going at, you know, you have this question of strategy actually. It can be different for different. Yeah, that's okay. Yeah. Why we debate on that? That's okay, accepted. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Preeta.